First of all, thank you for inviting me to come, and it's an absolute pleasure to be at this great place, which I've heard so much about over the years. The subject I'm talking about, topological matter, is one that actually spans across a number of fields of physics these days. It's very, very popular in condensed matter physics, but it's also very important in quantum information, and many of its roots go back to a lot of high energy physics work, especially string theory work, which was done starting in about the 1980s. However, its real roots go back much further, way back into the 1800s, which is where I'm going to start my story, and you'll forgive me if I start with a little bit of a historical and long digression, but I do promise I will get back to physics before the end of the talk. So our story starts in 1867 up in Scotland with two very well-known physicists of the time, one of them William Thomson. People probably know better as Lord Kelvin, and I'm sure everyone knows many of the great things that Lord Kelvin did. The other one is much less well-known, but also an extremely good scientist, a guy by the name of Peter Tate. So quick show of hands, how many people who have not heard the talk before have heard about Peter Tate? Okay, well, that's not very many, but congratulations to the two of you. Peter Tate was a very, very good scientist. And he was a very close friend of Lord Kelvin, and they worked together throughout their lives. Tate lived in Edinburgh, and Kelvin lived in Glasgow, which is just about short enough that you can go back and forth pretty easily. And they did this, and they collaborated on many things. In 1867, they had read some work by Helmholtz about fluid dynamics, actually a phenomenon in fluid dynamics that they were interested in. And this phenomenon is something that was extremely familiar to pretty much everyone in the world at the time. It's this phenomenon of a smoke ring. So let me remind you what a smoke ring is. So you take a ring, draw it in the middle of the air, and then the fluid, the smoke, or the air, circulates around that ring, sort of this way, and then the whole thing comes out of the plane of the board at you. Now, back in the old days, people used to do this thing called smoking tobacco. They don't do that anymore because it's bad for you. Everyone was certainly familiar with the phenomenon of the smoke ring. And Peter Tate asked himself whether he could build a machine that would produce these smoke rings such that he could study them. It turns out to be quite easy to build. If you've never built one yourself, you can look on YouTube and see how to build them and see how they work. You basically take a big can like a garbage can, you fill it with smoke, and you hit the back, and a smoke ring comes out the front. And they're really impressive to play with and to watch, because you can make a smoke ring very easily, which is about a meter in diameter, and it will fly through the air for 20 or 30 meters, maybe 40 meters, before it dissipates and you can't see it anymore. So Tate built such a machine, and he showed it to Lord Kelvin, and Lord Kelvin was really amazed by it and was inspired and had a number of simultaneous epiphanies. The first epiphany is something we still teach to undergraduates in fluid dynamics classes. It became known as Kelvin's circulation theorem, and the circulation theorem is basically, the content of the theorem is that were it not for the friction in the air, the viscosity or the dissipation in the air, this smoke ring would last forever. It would just keep spinning around and around and around and around. It would be completely stable, and it would just keep going. The only reason it dissipates at all is because air is not a perfect fluid. It has friction, it has dissipation, it has viscosity. So that got him thinking, well, where can I find such a perfect fluid that doesn't have any sort of friction in it? Such fluids do exist, such as superfluid helium. Cool helium down to very low temperature, it loses all of its viscosity. And indeed, if you had a smoke ring in superfluid helium, it would last forever. However, Kelvin didn't know about superfluid helium. They didn't have cryogenics, so they couldn't cool things down. They hadn't even discovered helium, as a matter of fact, in 1867, so he certainly didn't know about this. But there is something he thought he knew about. He thought he knew about a perfect dissipationless fluid, something that everyone believed in at the time. It's a famous mistake in the scientific literature, and that mistake is known as ether. Now, to remind you what ether is supposedly this perfectly dissipationless, frictionless fluid that fills all of space, and its purpose was to carry electromagnetic waves. Now, why would you want such a thing? Well, even in the 1800s, they knew an awful lot about waves. They saw when there was a wave on the water, what they were looking at was water sloshing back and forth. And when they heard a wave of sound in the air, what they realized was air moving back and forth. And they knew that light was a wave, but they didn't see anything moving back and forth, so they just conjectured that such a stuff must exist. In fact, all of Maxwell's papers on electromagnetism were phrased in the context of this is what the ether fluid is doing. The idea of ether actually goes back several hundred years before to René Descartes, who thought this stuff up. He said, I think, therefore it is, and it appeared. And okay, everyone got that joke, good. Sometimes people don't get it, actually. But for hundreds of years, the scientific community believed in ether, and so did Kelvin. And they knew this ether stuff had to be extremely dissipationless because you can see light from stars very, very, very far away. So Kelvin believed in this ether stuff, which is a perfectly dissipationless fluid, and he had this circulation theorem that tells him that a smoke ring in the ether would be stable for all time. So he said, well, what would such a fluid flow configuration in the ether be? And he came to a rather remarkable conclusion, and he said, well, maybe this fluid flow, the smoke ring in the ether, maybe this is an atom. So he said, maybe this thing is an atom, like a hydrogen atom, and you could have a more complicated fluid flow configuration, maybe something like that looks like linked rings, where the fluid flows around this one in this way, and then flows around this one in this way. And by Kelvin's circulation theorem, that fluid flow configuration would be stable for all time, and maybe this is something like a hydrogen molecule, and then you could have even a more complicated fluid flow configuration, something like, let's see, maybe this one goes under like this and over like this and something like, so maybe like this. There, is that knotted? Yeah, I think that's knotted. Did I get that right? No, that's unknotted. Okay, like this. Yeah, some sort of knot like that. Okay, this is a knot. And is that a knot? That's a knot. Yeah, that's a knot. And the fluid would flow around it this way and then around this way, and so forth and so on, like this. And by Kelvin's circulation theorem, this fluid flow configuration would be stable for all time, and maybe that's a more complicated atom like lithium, because they didn't know about helium. So this sounds completely ridiculous to us right now, because we know atoms are not made of vortex rings in the ether. We know there's no such thing as ether. We know atoms are made of electrons and protons and neutrons. So why am I telling you about this? Well, this will become important in a moment, but let me continue with the story, and then I'll come back to why it's important. Kelvin proposed this, what became known as the vortex theory of the atom, in an attempt to explain the periodic table of the elements. And it was actually a very popular theory for about 10 years. And many of the world's best scientists, people like Maxwell, Kirchhoff, Helmholtz, Kelvin, thought very highly of this theory. They thought this is the way forward. And even though it sounds ridiculous to us now, it was really looked very good at the time, because it claimed to answer two of the fundamental questions that were really burning in the scientific community at the time. Those two questions that it claimed to answer was, one, why are the atoms discrete? And two, why are they immutable? Well, they're discrete because there's only so many different kinds of knots you can draw on the board. This is the simplest knot, this is the next most simple knot, this is the next most simple knot, and so forth and so on. And they're immutable because of Kelvin's circulation theorem. This fluid flow configuration will never turn into this fluid flow configuration. The knots in this fluid flow, these knots will never become unknotted, because that is the content of the circulation theorem. But despite this rather pretty picture, there were some people who, even very early on, said that, it's a nice and pretty picture, but it may not have anything to do with reality. And one of the people who criticized it very early on was Peter Tate. And he said, it's a pretty picture, but really what you would want of your theory is you would want it to predict something about the atoms, like their masses, their chemistry, their electrical properties, their optical properties. And this vortex theory of the atom predicted none of those things in any way whatsoever, so it's probably wrong. But nonetheless, the scientific community took it seriously for 10 years. During those 10 years, what was Peter Tate doing? He was off golfing. And I'm serious, he was a fantastic golfer. He wrote some beautiful papers about the flight of golf balls. He was instrumental in putting the dimples on the golf balls. His son, Freddie, he taught Freddie to golf. Freddie became a champion. Is anyone a huge golf fanatic? If you were, you would know the name Freddie Tate. He was a champion of the British Open. So he's really involved in golfing. At the end of about 10 years, most of the scientific community had sort of given up on the vortex theory of the atom, for exactly the reasons that Peter Tate had stated to begin with. It just didn't seem to correspond to reality. Peter Tate comes back into the scientific community looking at this. I mean, he had been doing science in the meantime, but he hadn't been interested in this. But he comes back and looks at it again, and he says, you know what? I kind of like this theory. And what we really need to do that people aren't doing is we need to understand knots. We need to understand knots really, really well. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to build a periodic table of all possible knots. And if I make a periodic table of all possible knots, the simplest, next simplest, next simplest, and so forth, I will then know something important about the periodic table of the elements. So he devoted a lot of the remainder of his life into developing what became the mathematical branch which we now call knot theory. And this field of study in mathematics is an extremely rich and beautiful and important field of topology, and it views Peter Tate as being the father of the field. The number of things he discovered was amazing. Some of his conjectures about the theory of knots were only proven in the 1990s. So he's way, way ahead of his time. Now, I'm going to explain one of the key things that he discovered, that he realized, which comes back to be important to physics and important to this story. But first, I can't resist telling you the end of what happened to Peter Tate. So Peter Tate, nearing the end of his life, in around 1900, he's getting kind of old. He's actually quite depressed about the fact that he had spent so much of his life working on, you know, building this periodic table of the knots. The Tate table of the knots, you know, lasted, you know, it's still out there. It's known as the Tate table. You know, he has his periodic table of the knots, and he feels like, you know, he's no closer to understanding the periodic table of the elements. And he writes some letters to his friend Lord Kelvin saying how depressed he was about this. He had wasted so much of his scientific career. And then, you know, to make matters much worse, his son Freddie, the champion golfer, was killed very young in the Boer Wars in South Africa. That sent Peter Tate into a deep depression, feeling, you know, having lost his son and feeling like he had wasted so much of his productive scientific life, and he dies two months later. So it was actually a very sad end for a very great scientist. What he didn't realize, being depressed about having wasted his life, is that he had launched a huge and incredibly productive field of mathematics, but he didn't see its relevance to physics, which would only come, you know, 100 years later, more or less. Okay, so what was it that Peter Tate realized in his exploration of knot theory, which is going to be important for us? So the main question in the theory of knots is the question of topological equivalence. So if you draw a picture of a knot like this, a very simple picture of a knot, the question is that the same thing as this picture here, or is it different? In other words, can this be deformed into this without cutting any of the strands? If so, we say they're topologically equivalent knots. It's only one entry on the periodic table of the knots. If not, we say they're topologically different, and it's two entries on the periodic table of the knots. Now, this looks like it's a pretty easy question to answer. We can just unfold this picture here, and then it turns into this. Is that clear to everyone in their heads? Good. But it actually turns out to be rapidly extremely difficult when you start making more complicated knots like this one, and things much more complicated than that. It becomes extremely difficult to tell when two knots are equivalent and when they're not. And in order to help you build the periodic table of knots, what you need is a tool, a mathematical tool, and this is what Peter Tate understood, although he didn't use this language. He certainly understood this. What he needed was what is known as a knot invariant. And a knot invariant, used in mathematics all the time, is a mapping from a picture of a knot as an input to some output via some set of rules. And the idea is that in order to be a knot invariant, the rules have to be cooked up in such a way that topologically equivalent knots always give the same output. So if you have two knots, you don't know if they're the same or they're different, you put them into your set of rules, you get some output. If the outputs are different, you know immediately the two knots are two different entries on the periodic table of the knots. Okay? So it's sort of a machine for converting a knot into some output. And the output can be like a number, or it can be a polynomial, or it can be, you know, really almost anything, but it should be something that should be easy to compare to each other. So you put the knot in, you don't know how to compare the two knots to each other, you get some output that you can compare to each other. That's the idea of a knot invariant. So to give you an idea of what these things are like, I'm going to use the example of a very simple but extremely important knot invariant known as the Kaufman invariant, which was invented by Von Jones, not by Kaufman. Von Jones, if you don't know, is a mathematician who won the Fields Medal. That's like the, yes?
Sorry, I was just curious. Are these knot invariants, is it also true that two knots are the same output? Are they necessarily topologically?
It is not true. That is actually, you can tell when two knots are different. It's hard to tell when they're the same. Now, it's one of the, probably the most important open questions in knot theory is, can you find a knot invariant which will uniquely distinguish all the knots from each other? And people, there are conjectures about this, but there are no proofs. Okay. It's a great field to incidentally, I should, so Von Jones won a Fields Medal, like the Nobel Prize in Mathematics for his, yes, another question.
Are you talking about three
dimensions? So the knots live in three dimensions. I'm going to draw the knots in two dimensions. Obviously, okay, but but in some sense, knot theory works in the sense that when you have a set of rules, you're always projecting the knot to a plane to draw it, and then the output. So when typically the set of rules will be in regards to a particular projection of the three-dimensional knot to two dimensions, and then you apply it to that. Yes.
Yeah. Is the theory itself focused on one-dimensional lines and three dimensions?
So okay, so it's
that mathematicians typically don't stick to three dimensions.
Yeah, okay, so we are thinking about, we will always think about one-dimensional lines living in three dimensions.
Yes.
And there's a question as to whether you have to choose a projection of that three dimensions to two dimensions, which we will do.
Okay.
And there are this is sort of a subtle and interesting question to ask which knot invariants are projection can be phrased without saying you project first and then show its projection independent at the end. Okay. Yes.
So finally, a success of the atomic theory of knots would have been that charge, for example, was a knot invariant.
That would be really wonderful if it were true. Yes. Yeah. Yeah. Unfortunately, there was no such success. Yeah. Although, strangely enough, there were scientific papers written about the vortex theory of the atom long after people more or less accepted that there was no ether, that there were some holdouts who really resisted the ether and still thought about the vortex theory of the atom actually into the 1920s. So, all right. So Jones is a famous mathematician. Kaufman is also a famous mathematician. He didn't win the Fields Medal, but what he did was he translated what Jones was doing into a language that pretty much anyone can understand, which is what I'm going to explain to you now. Incidentally, Kaufman, if you're interested in this field, Kaufman wrote an incredibly gorgeous book, which I read when I was a graduate student, called Knots in Physics, which was totally inspirational to me and changed my life. So if you haven't read the book, you should read it. Actually, really only read part one of the book. Part two is not as good. So, it's a great, great book anyway, but okay. So to define the Kaufman invariant, you have to, it's really just a couple of things you need. So first you need to choose a number, and we'll call that number A. A equals A number, that's why we call it A. So A is a number. For now, we're gonna leave it as a variable. In a little bit, we might give it a value. The second rule is pretty simple. If you ever have a loop of string in your knot with nothing going through it, you can replace that loop by the combination minus a squared minus a to the minus 2. And that combination comes up so often, we give it a name and we call it D. Okay, so a loop of string is worth D. The next rule is that if you have two strings, a picture with two strings crossing over each other like this, you can replace that picture by a sum of two pictures. In the first picture, the strings will go vertically. And in the second picture, the strings will go horizontally. And in the first picture, there's a coefficient of A out front. And the second picture has a coefficient of A inverse out front. Now, what am I doing here? What I'm doing is I'm doing algebra with pictures, OK? You have a picture with a crossing, and I'm going to replace it with a sum of two pictures. And the pictures will get coefficients out front. Now, if it's not clear what I mean by this, hold on, because I'm going to do an example of it, which will clarify everything, hopefully, OK? So this is all the rules you actually really need for the Kaufman invariant, but I'm going to cheat a little bit, and I'm going to draw another rule. And the other rule is exactly the same as this rule, except I'm going to rotate all of the pictures by 90 degrees. And the reason I'm doing this is because it's a lot easier to draw the rule twice than it is to ask you to rotate your head at a later moment. Okay. There, okay. So that's all the rules we need. So I'm now going to, before your very eyes, I'm going to evaluate the Kaufman invariant of this knot here. And the way I do that is I look at this picture and I see that in this picture there is a crossing of two strings in that circle, which looks just like this crossing over here. So within that green circle, I can replace that crossing with A times vertical plus A inverse times horizontal. And then the rest of the knot just stays exactly the same as it is over here on the left. So I just close it up on the top in both cases. And then on the bottom, it has to cross over like this and go under like that. And cross over like this and go under like that. OK, is it clear now what I've done, what I meant by this? So if you got this, you got everything else for the rest of the day. This is the most important moment of your day. Okay. Okay, it's the most important moment of the hour at any rate. So, okay. So now in these two pictures, we have another crossing here and here. So I'm going to do the same thing on these crossings, and I guess that looks like this lower crossing here. So I'll do this a little bit more quickly. So here I have to bring down this A, then I'm going to open up a bracket. And then I have an A times a vertical plus an A inverse times a horizontal. And then I'm going to fill in the rest of the knot exactly like it is upstairs, like this. Fill in the rest of the knot like this, like that, and then close the bracket. And then we have an A inverse here. That's this A inverse. Open up a bracket. And then we have an A times a vertical plus an A inverse times a horizontal, and then we fill in the, did you make a mistake? Yeah?
I actually, for the first picture, wouldn't it be the other way around since the one on top is kind of going to the right, like in the bottom picture?
Did I mess it up? No, it's okay. They claim it's okay. So the top one, I'm using a different rule. The top one, I'm using this rule, and this bottom one, I use this rule. Because the sense of the crossing is opposite. Did I mess something up?
You used the first rule.
Oh no. No, you're right. I messed up. You're right. This should be horizontal. You're absolutely right. This should be horizontal. This should be vertical. I'm sorry. I can't even read my notes right. Okay. There, okay. Absolutely right. I stand corrected. Yes, I did have a mistake. So this, yeah, you're right. I used the first rule. I should have used the second rule. Okay, is it clear what I did now? Okay, the problem was I didn't pay attention to the most important part of the day. Okay. All right. Okay, so now I have this. Really sorry about that. So now I have this picture reduced to just a bunch of loops. And each time I have a loop, I can replace the loop with a factor of D. Everything that's left, there's no crossings left. So here I have A squared times two loops, which is D squared, A times D squared. The A cancels the A inverse, I just have D. I have A canceling A inverse, so D cubed, three loops, and then A minus two times two loops, D squared. Okay? Everyone with me? Okay.
Why just D squared rather than 2D?
Because that's the way the rule works. The rule works if you have two loops, you get D squared. Okay? So I'm defining my knot invariant. Now this picture is just a little bit of algebra. The algebra we need to do here is to realize that D is the same as minus A squared minus A to minus 2. So I can put together this factor and this factor and get a minus D cubed. Minus D cubed, right? Because A squared plus A to the minus 2 is minus D. So this minus D cubed cancels this D cubed. And at the end of the day, all I get is D. Yay. OK. Why is that so exciting, as I have indicated here? So the reason that's so exciting is because this knot that we started with up here, well, it looked a little complicated. But secretly, we knew that it was actually just a loop, OK? And the knot in the Kaufman invariant of a loop is D. Now, even though we made the knot look a little bit more complicated by folding it over, still, the knot invariant comes out to be D. And I could have taken this knot and I could have folded it over 100 times and made it look incredibly complicated so you have no idea what it was. And still, at the end of the day, when you calculate the Kaufman invariant, it's D. Okay? That's how knot invariants work. Yes? Do we need to choose a number for A? We don't need to choose one yet. We will choose one later. Yeah. So right now, it's just a polynomial. Yeah.
So I guess how difficult is it to apply this algorithm to an arbitrary knot?
Yeah. So that is exactly my next point. So since you're thinking ahead, and I was going to say if you're very clever, as obviously you are, you will notice. That in fact it starts to get increasingly difficult to apply this algorithm to complicated knots. It's exponentially complex in the number of crossings you have in your knot. So in this particular picture, there are two crossings and we ended up with four diagrams at the end of the day. If we had three crossings, we would have eight diagrams, and four crossings, we would have 16 diagrams, and so forth and so on. And we all know how exponentials end. They always end unhappily. And so you might think, you know, for really complicated knots, this is not very useful. When you think about it, it's really, really easy to draw on the blackboard a knot with 100 crossings. And 2 to the 100th is such an enormous number that if I, you know, gave a computer this really complicated knot to try to evaluate the Kaufman invariant, it would take the world's largest computer the age of the universe to try to, you know, calculate the Kaufman invariant. So you might think, okay, maybe this isn't so useful after all. So we'll come back to that in a moment. Well, in a little bit. Before the end of the talk, I promise we'll get back to that. Okay, so now, so after having taught you something interesting about the theory of knots, I'm going to switch gears and tell you about something which sounds like it's extremely different, but in fact is more or less exactly the same. So that is the idea of a topological quantum field theory. I'll write that down. Topological quantum field theory. Field theory, or TQFT. And a topological quantum field theory is any quantum mechanical system, or field theory, if you want, where amplitudes depend on topology, not on geometry. Let me repeat that again, because it's really important. Amplitudes depend on topology, not on geometry. So to put a little bit more meaning on that statement, we have to all take a step back and think about quantum mechanics the way that Richard Feynman taught us to. So Feynman had a very simple rule about quantum mechanics, and his rule is that if you want to find the amplitude of getting from some initial configuration of particles or fields in, you know, some initial time to some final configuration at some later time, even if you're coming from the vacuum back to the vacuum, what you have to do is you have to sum over everything that can possibly happen in between. So he says that your amplitude of getting from the beginning to the end, which I'm going to take vacuum to vacuum in this particular case, so I'll call it z for a partition function, that should be the sum over all paths from the beginning to the end of e to the I action of the path divided by h bar. And that's all there is to quantum mechanics in the Richard Feynman prescription. Now, everything I'm going to talk about today is going to be, as I said before, in three dimensions. And I have to keep track of time. So what we're talking about here is two-dimensional systems, and time is going to be in the vertical direction. So let me draw them here. So time is going this way, and I'm going to draw a two-dimensional system here. So this is my disk where my system lives. And let's imagine it starting in its ground state configuration or its vacuum configuration. So there are no excitations. It's living in its ground state. And I want to know what's the amplitude of it starting in the ground state and ending back in the ground state later. What's the partition function of the system in a different language? So what you have to do is you have to sum over everything that can happen between the initial and the final times. One of the things that can happen, for example, is at some time a particle hole pair could come out of the vacuum. So sort of pair creation can occur. Particle antiparticle, if you want to think about it that way. And then maybe at a later time, maybe there's another particle hole creation event. Particle and a hole come out of the vacuum. and I'll something like this. Maybe one particle walks around another particle and they come back together at some later time and re-annihilate, maybe like this, and they re-annihilate. Okay? And this is some process. It's the, you know, it's the, what they call the fascist rule of quantum mechanics. If it's not forbidden, it's absolutely required. So this has to be included in the sum somewhere. Okay, so now I'm going to draw another space-time process that can occur. So here is my same disk. And I'm going to draw another space-time process that maybe occurs, maybe like this, and maybe like this, something like that. Okay, now in this picture, you know, again, you have something where particles appear and disappear, something like this. But it looks somewhat different from this picture here. It's, the shape is sort of different. But the key here is that in a topological quantum field theory, the amplitude for this occurring and the amplitude for this occurring are the same, because amplitudes depend on topology, not on geometry. Okay, these are topologically equivalent. They can be deformed into each other without cutting any of the strands. So the amplitudes should be the same in a topological quantum field theory. Now, one should be a little bit disturbed by this, because we're used to the idea in most of our quantum mechanical systems that amplitudes depend on things like how fast particles are moving, what their energy is, how far apart they are. But I'm telling you, no, in a topological quantum field theory, the amplitudes depend only on the topology of the space-time process that occurred, the fact that we've created two particles, one went around the other, and they came back and re-annihilated. And that's the only thing that's important. Yes?
Can they interact, or is that...
Okay, that's part of the... That would be, if it's part of the field theory, they can interact, but it has to respect this rule, that it, otherwise it's not topological anymore. So the interaction that's there has to obey the rule, otherwise it's not topological. Now you can, there are, you know, if you go a little bit deeper, you can have topological quantum field theory with things that aren't topological stuck on top of it. It's a little bit more complicated, but, you know, people do discuss these things as well. But we're going to stick with pure topological quantum field theories here. Now, rather... famously, there's a sort of deep connection between topological quantum field theories and knot invariants. What is that connection? Well, this factor here, this amplitude, has to be a knot invariant. Why? Well, it's a mapping from a knot to an output via a set of rules, and the rules depend only on the topology of the knot that I drew. Okay, so this thing here is a knot invariant. Now, this connection was exploited very... famously by Ed Witten. Ed Witten was for a very long time the world's most prominent string theorist, one of the creators of string theory. Ed Witten won a Fields Medal for his work in knot theory, actually, in the mathematical theory of knots, along with Von Jones, for exploiting this connection. Now, in his initial paper on knots and topological quantum field theories, is an extremely beautiful paper, and every single time I read it, I'm still marvel about it. I recommend it highly. It's not easy going. But one of the things that's in this paper is he actually makes a clear connection between certain types of topological quantum field theories that are known and certain knot invariants. In particular, let me these are maybe just names for now, but there are certain types of topological quantum field theories called SU2 level K. So SU2, people are probably familiar with that. That is the gauge group of the field theory. K is an integer, which has to be an integer. It's the coupling constant of the field theory, if you like. And what he found, I mean, these SU2 level K Chern-Simons theories were understood to some extent already in the 1980s, and what he realized was that if you want to know the amplitude of some particular process in that field theory, all you have to do is calculate the Kaufman invariant with the right value of this number A. So all you do is you plug in A equal, oh, let me just put it here, A equals I times e to the I pi over 2k plus 2. And then once you plug that in, you have the amplitude of the particular process in the topological quantum field theory. Now, what is maybe... You know, there's an awful lot of mathematics that goes into this, but what's maybe the most incredible thing is that these things are not just a figment of Ed Witten's imagination. They actually exist in nature, or at least we believe they do, and there's a sort of growing list of physical systems that which we believe obey this type of topological quantum field theory properties. And what, so now I will tell you what I mean by this part of my title, topologically ordered matter. Topologically ordered matter is a word that roughly means any physical system which is described at long wavelength and low temperature as a topological quantum field theory. So it's a physical manifestation of a topological quantum field theory with these sort of interesting properties associated with its braiding and its knotting, that amplitudes depend only on topology and not on geometry. So let me just make a sort of short list of the different physical systems that fall into this category. So rather prominently, there's the SU2 level 2 class, which is maybe the most common to occur in nature. Nu equals 5/2 fractional quantum Hall effect is the one that we're most convinced of, or has probably been studied the most. Strontium ruthenate films in 2D. Strontium ruthenate is a superconductor. Strontium ruthenate 2D films. In order to stay in three dimensions, since time is one of your dimensions, your physical system has to be two-dimensional. So you take your superconductor, you make it two-dimensional, and now you have a topological quantum field theory for this particular superconductor, which has interesting properties. Helium 3A superfluid film as well. And then there's sort of a large number of what you might call engineered near spin orbit superconductor, the kind of things that Shankar Dasarma and Jay Sow have been working on, sort of a growing list of things, including Majorana wires and two-dimensional indium arsenide systems, which involve spin orbit superconductors. Spin orbit and superconductors all coupled together. It also fits in this SU2 level 2 class. I won't say too much more about this, though. There's also the SU2 level 3 class, of which there's one quantum Hall state believed to fit into that, HE. Then there's an SU2 level 4 class, which is more questionable. There is one, it's 2 plus 2/3 supposed to live there. And there's one more, which is SU3 level 2, which is believed to exist. This is a different, it's not Kaufman invariant, but it's a different topological quantum field theory. Okay. At this point, I will head off the obvious question that everyone always asks. Is this related to topological insulators? The answer is yes and no. It is closely related to topological insulators, but there is no interesting braiding physics associated with any of the particles in most regular topological, non-superconducting topological insulators. I won't say much more about that. Okay. Yes?
These are not electron paths.
These are not electron paths. These are the quasi-particle. Pass, yes. Yeah. It's a rule about the excitations, not the underlying electrons. That's right. Those have all been integrated out. Yeah. Yeah, these are the quasi-particle excitations. The electrons are always electrons. Okay. Okay, so 3+1 dimensions do have topological models as well. They are less well understood and less common. But yes, at least you can write down Hamiltonians which have topological properties in 3+1 dimensions, but you will realize that you can't have knotting of world lines in 3+1 dimensions. You can always untie your shoes in 4 dimensions. You know, there's no, okay, that was a bad, you can't make a knot of one-dimensional lines within a 4-dimensional space. That's a problem. And if that's not obvious, ask me afterwards and I will prove that to you. Okay. But you can have knotting of sheets, 2-dimensional manifolds within 4 dimensions. So these things are considered. Okay. Before going on, let me, I'm going to say more about topological quantum field theories and topologically ordered matter and also about why you should care, that last part of my title. But before doing so, I have to do a little bit of truth in advertising because I know what's going to happen is that everyone is going to go home and try to calculate the Kaufman invariant of your favorite knot. Because everyone has a favorite knot, I'm sure. And unless you know this one little catch, you're going to be very upset with me. So let me tell you about this one little catch. So I'm going to take a little piece of a knot like this, and you know, imagine that the rest is connected up somewhere. I'm not so interested where it's connected up and what happens over there. I'm just going to calculate the Kaufman invariant of this little piece. So here we have a crossing. I guess it looks like this upper crossing. Make sure I get it right this time. So I can replace it by A times vertical plus A inverse times horizontal. So now this gets connected up like this, and this gets connected up like this, and this goes off, and this goes off like this. Okay, and this becomes replaced by a D. So this thing gets straightened out, so I get A times D plus A inverse times this dotted straight line dotted. Okay, and this combination here is minus A cubed times a straight line. Okay, everyone follow that? Happy? Okay, at this point you should be very upset with me. And if it's not clear why you should be upset with me, just remember that I promised you that two knots that can be deformed into each other without cutting should have the same Kaufman invariant. And here, these things look like they could be deformed into each other without cutting, and now I've told you that no, they differ by the prefactor of minus A cubed. So what's going on? So what's going on is that, in fact, these two can't be deformed into each other without cutting. They're actually different. And to realize why they're different, you have to realize that these strings here are not infinitely thin, but you should think of them as being ribbons or like a garden hose. They're kind of thick. So we give them some sort of thickness, like this, and you realize if you take this picture and you pull it tight, what you get is something that looks like this, not something that looks like this. Okay? All right? It's you know, if you ever straightened a garden hose, you know what I'm talking about? That it always, sort of always twists around and stuff like this. Okay. So this factor of minus a cubed here accounts for the fact that we're undoing this twist. And this is actually something that we should expect in quantum mechanics, because we know in quantum mechanics, particles can have spin. And if they have spin, if you rotate around yourself, this is what this picture is doing. It's rotating around itself. The particle is sort of turning around like this. And if the particle is turning around, it can pick up a phase associated with its spin. And this factor here is just that phase. You'll notice that A here is magnitude 1, is just a complex phase. So this thing is the phase associated with the spin of the particle. Okay, so this thing is not equal to this. It's equal to this. And then it's equal to this time. Okay, you can undo that twist by adding a factor of minus A cubed. Okay. In fact, just a little bit of a side comment. Relating this to this is sort of the quickest proof of the famous spin statistics theorem. So spin statistics says that two particles exchanged should be the same phase as one particle twisted around itself. And in fact, that's exactly what we've done. We pulled this straight, and we've seen that here there's two particles exchanged, two identical particles exchanged, and here it's just one particle twisting around each other, and you just get it by pulling it straight. Okay? All right. So now you're prepared to go home and calculate the Kaufman invariant of your favorite knot. Okay. All right. So let me move on to what the interesting properties are of these topological quantum field theories of this topological matter. And there's probably one property that's much more important than any other property that you might consider. And that property is the following. So here's our two-dimensional system again. And I'm going to imagine having, you know, a particle and an antiparticle, a particle and an antiparticle, a particle and a hole. So two particles, two holes in the system. Now, for most systems that you might consider, insulators, superconductors, any system with a gap, if you sort of tell me, okay, I started in the ground state and I put in some particles and I put in some holes, you've told me the wave function of the system. You've told me exactly what wave function you have. But I'm telling you in these topological quantum field theories, that's not true. You can have two. I'm going to draw one that's exactly identical over here. Or it's supposed to look exactly identical. I can have two linearly independent states. I'll call them 1 and 2, where the particles and the holes are exactly in the same place. And whatever local quantum numbers they have, like spin or whatever, that those are exactly the same in this picture and this picture, but they're different states. How is that possible? Well, in topological quantum field theories, you remember the space-time history. Why is that? Well, let's see. This and this could have appeared in space-time in two different ways. One way is like this, and the other way is like this. And these things are topologically different from each other, and so they can be different wave functions, different physical wave functions. And to check that they're different physical wave functions, the way we do this is we take inner products. So to take an inner product, we need both the bra and the ket. So to make the ket, the corresponding ket, we just time reverse things and return the particles to the vacuum. So the ket associated with 1 would look like this. 1 equals this thing. And then we return the things to the vacuum exactly in the opposite way. So that's the 1 ket and the 1 bra over here. And here's the 2 bra like this. and returns this way. Okay? And in order to find an inner product between, you know, 1 and 1 or 1 and 2 or something like that, we just have to squeeze them together and make a sandwich. Then we have a knot and we evaluate the knot. So let's do that. So let's take 1 on 1 like this. And so here's the physical system in the middle. One bra kind of looks like this. And one ket looks like this. And we realize that thing looks to just two loops like this. So this is worth d squared. And we do the same thing with 2 on 2. Okay, so here's and then here's 2 bra like this. This is two loops like this. This is, again, d squared. However, if we take 1 on 2, we get something that looks like this. So 1 on the top looks like this, and 2 on the bottom looks like this. That is just one loop, and that is worth d. Okay? And so that tells you, I mean, the fact that 1 on 1 is one value, 2 on 2 is the same value, but 1 on 2 is a different value, tells that 1 and 2 are linearly independent wave functions. There's a Hilbert space spanned by two dimensions here. Okay? Now, you can do things that are more complicated as well. You can do, you know, you can put things in between the bra and the ket, like a complicated braid. So maybe something like this. I don't know, something like this. This one goes around and over and under and this, and this one ends up here, and this one kind of goes over and under and under and over and through there, like this. And so you can evaluate the Kaufman invariant of this thing as well, and this would be 1 times braid times 1. And what the braid is doing is implementing some sort of unitary rotation in this two-dimensional Hilbert space. Okay? Now, this finally brings me to the last part of the title of my talk, which is why on earth should you care? Well, if I had, instead of calling them 1 and 2, yes?
It sounds like what you're describing actually would make it impossible to describe anything, because you would have to know the prehistory going back forever. You could never even start.
Well, no. I mean, you can start in a system with which has no excitations in it. And once you start with a system with no excitations, absolute ground state, then you start pulling particles out of the vacuum.
But you don't have to worry about.
Don't have to worry about things before that. Once you're in the vacuum, you're back to the vacuum.
But the way it got to the vacuum.
You don't have to worry about how it got to the vacuum. I think you can always throw that away. It will. Yeah, I mean, if you go through all the detailed rules of the topological quantum field theory, I promise you that that will be okay. So you don't have to worry about things that happened before time infinity way back there. Yes? Torus, you have to worry about, yeah, okay. So there's topological issues associated with being on different different manifolds. I'm assuming everything's on a sphere or a plane. Yeah. Okay, so why should I care? I'm back to this question, why should I care? Instead of calling this thing 1 and 2, if I called it 0 and 1, you would have immediately thought of a qubit. And this is exactly why we should care, because one wants to build a quantum computer with these sort of things. Now, you know, someone once said that any idiot with a two-state system thinks they have a qubit. and, you know, maybe it's a little bit exaggerated, but what I want to do is, first I have to convince you of two things. The first thing I have to convince you of is that you can do quantum computation with this sort of setup, and secondly, I have to convince you that it's a good idea, you know, that we're not just any idiot proposing some crazy qubit, that in fact this is a really smart thing to do. So this scheme of what they call topological quantum computation, I'll give a little bit more detail of this in a moment, it was cooked up by two verified geniuses. One is Michael Friedman, who is another Fields Medalist. He won his Fields Medal for work on the Poincaré conjecture. He's probably been here many times. And the other one is Alexei Kateyev, who is MacArthur and this Milner Prize winner, and you know, all. Anyway, both of them very, very genuinely smart people. Both of them very nice guys, also, for whatever that's worth. Okay, so how is it we're going to do some sort of quantum computation? So the general idea of how you're going to do quantum computation is the following. You take your big two-dimensional system, and you start it in the vacuum state, okay, at some initial time. Then you create lots of particle hole pairs. And for each two pairs we came up with, we had a qubit. Okay, we had a two-state system. So here we've made a whole bunch of qubits. And so this is the initialization of your quantum computer. Then the way you do your computation is by wrapping the particles around each other in some predetermined knot. And we did spent a lot of time figuring out which knots correspond to which computations. And it's not hard to figure out which knots you have to form. And then at the end of the day, you return them to the vacuum, and you make a measurement. So the measurement is to notice that when you try to return them to the vacuum, some of them actually go back to the vacuum, and some of them leave something behind, which you measure, and that is then your output, or your readout. OK, now, how can I convince you that, that you can do quantum computation this way? Well, it kind of looks like you might. You have an initialization of qubits. You have some sort of unitary operation. You have some sort of readout at the end of the day. But let me give you a sort of a simpler explanation of why it is that you could do quantum computation. Remember back at the beginning of the talk, your question, you said for big complicated knots, you have an exponentially hard problem that no computer in the world could calculate the Kaufman invariant of a knot with 100 crossings. Well, if you had one of these topological quantum field theories in your laboratory and you wanted to know the Kaufman invariant or estimate the Kaufman invariant, you could do it very easily by forming the physical knot that you want and then measuring the amplitude that it all went back to the vacuum. And that would give you just the square of the Kaufman invariant, which is something that you cannot calculate on a classical computer, in a million years if it's a complicated knot. But you could do it with this topological quantum field theory. Now, it's maybe a little less obvious that that is equivalent to being able to do things like Shor's algorithm and, being able to crack codes and spy on your neighbors. But it turns out that that is equivalent in computational complexity. That if you can make these sort of calculations of the Kaufman invariant, you can also do all of those things as well. Now, the very last thing that I want to say, since it's supposed to end on the hour, so it appears I'm running out of time. So I guess the last thing I want to say is, why is it that people are so interested in this? So all of these physical systems over here are cryogenic, very low temperature, sub-Kelvin. Some of them are some millikelvin. Some of them are down to the microkelvin we're talking about. So these are incredibly hard experiments to do. They're complicated. They're messy. They have disorder. You would think this is maybe the worst way you would want to do quantum computation. So why is it people are interested? Well, first, we have to think about why is quantum computation hard in the first place. And the reason it's hard is because any coupling to the environment, any noise that hits your system, has typically the possibility of flipping over a qubit. And you have to go to great lengths to do some sort of error protection to prevent yourself from being affected by this noise. But let's look at this system here and imagine that some noise hits the system, noise. That noise can be a vibration, a phonon, or a photon, or something like that. And it hits one of these particles. And if it shakes this particle around in some complicated way like that, it didn't do anything. It left the knot exactly the same. As long as the knot is unchanged, as long as it's the same knot we're forming, we've done exactly the same computation and nothing has changed. So it's completely immune to small amounts of noise that shake your particles around. This is why people are interested in this approach. It's fundamentally secure against small amounts of noise. Now, I know you have a question. One second. If you hit it with enough noise such that this guy gets out of your control, you're presumably holding it in some trap or something. If it goes way off over here and makes some complicated knot that you didn't expect, then you've changed the calculation, and that will be a real error. But the idea is that as long as you can hold the particles at least roughly in the right space, and you keep them far apart from each other so they don't jump into each other's trap into each other's spot, then it's completely immune to noise. OK, yes, your question.
Are these systems typically gapless? Or?
They're all gapped.
Okay.
They're all typically gapped. There's some of them have Goldstone modes that are decoupled from the topological properties. So they have low energy excitations, but the low energy excitations don't do anything, so you don't worry about them. But all the quantum Hall states are all gapped. The noise has to be below, because the problem is that if you have noise above the gap, you create new particles, and the particles run around and make knots that you didn't expect. So you have to, whatever the noise it has to be below the gap. That's correct. Yeah. That's the limitation. Yeah. I was going to spend a few minutes. Let me, can I run over by 2 minutes? 2 minutes?
So
2 minutes. Okay. I want to just say a couple words about quantum Hall effect, which is sort of the prominent example of this. I'll be extremely brief about what quantum Hall effect is and why it is that we think it's a topological quantum field theory. So the very quick picture of what quantum Hall effect is, you take two-dimensional systems, actually it can be two-dimensional bosons, but it's, so far it's never been done with bosons, or at least appears to never have been done. There's at least one claim where it's been done, but people don't agree. But it's, most of quantum Hall effect is two-dimensional electrons in a very big magnetic field, and then you cool it down to low temperature, and out comes fractional quantum Hall effect. It's that easy. So there are various different quantum Hall effects which are distinguished by the filling fraction nu. I drew that over here there, which is approximately equal to the density times the flux quantum divided by the magnetic field. That can be tuned to various low integer ratios like 5 halves, 12 fifths, 1 third, and so forth. Each one of them is a different phase of matter, which we're going to be interested in. Now, in practice, there aren't that many measurements that you can actually do on one of these samples easily. The only thing that's really easy to do is to do some sort of conductivity measurement. So here's your sample in two dimensions. It has some random shape, and it's also dirty. It's full of all sorts of garbage that you don't control. And the only thing that you can do is you can put contacts on the sample in some random places, and it's not that well controlled because you're doing it under a microscope, sort of soldering on these contacts. And then you can measure. You can run current through it here, and you can measure voltage over here, for example. And if you do this experiment always gives you the answer zero, that you measure zero voltage. This is a completely dissipationless system. That's kind of interesting. It's like a superconductor. But that doesn't tell you that it's like, you know, some magical topological state. The more interesting experiment is the following, that if you cross the current and voltage leads like this, measuring the so-called Hall resistance, what you measure is that the voltage is 1 over this nu. This nu is a ratio of integers times h over e squared, that's Planck's constant and the charge of electron, times the current you flow. And this number is quantized to a part in, as well as you want to, a part in a billion, a part in 10 billion, some incredibly high level of quantization of this ratio. And that's independent of the shape of the sample. This is, this should be strike you as absolutely incredible, because if you take a piece of copper and you measure voltages on the copper, it depends entirely on how far you put apart the contacts. And here it doesn't matter where you put the contacts. You put them anywhere you want. The sample can be full of disorder. You still get exactly the same ratio. That tells you something there that's going on is topological. And you're getting a topologically quantized result, which is robust to any sort of disorder in the sample or any change of shape of the sample, as long as the current and voltage leads are crossed. Now, the last thing I want to mention is, what are these particles that we're going to be braiding around each other to make knots? What these particles are is they're like little vortices and anti-vortices in this superfluid of the fractional quantum Hall effect. The quantum Hall effect is dissipationless, so it's like a superfluid. So these vortices, they persist for all time. They're stuck there because there's no way for them to dissipate away. And then it's these things that are the particles with the interesting braiding properties. And so this is actually looking an awful lot like what Kelvin was telling us about, 150 years ago. We have these vortices in the ether, which are stuck there because it's completely dissipationless, and we're going to drag them around each other to make knots. The only major difference between what Kelvin was thinking and what we're thinking now is that he was thinking about three spatial dimensions, and we're thinking about two spatial dimensions, and time is the third dimension. And that's really the only major difference between the two. So I will stop there and take any remaining questions, and thank you for your attention.